I've been carving spoons for years now. I think all my family and friends all have a set of spoons that I've made. It's just a simple design, very utilitarian for kitchen use. In fact, I fuss at people if they get spoons from me and they don't use them. So I intend for them to be used. One day I came across a YouTube video that showed a spoon mule, and I thought it would be a lot handier, a lot easier to use than my shop bench. I'd been using the end vise on my shop bench for carving, which worked fine, but this just seemed like it was a lot handier. With the downtime I've had recently, I decided to go ahead and make one. The bench is made of three parts. And there's the head, which you see here. There's the seat. And you see it comes out very easily, and the reason for that is you want it, you want to be able to slide the bench back and forth to adjust your work position in relation to the head. And then there's the bench itself, which is 4 feet long, made out of dimensional lumber. You see that I've got the front legs bolted on, and the back leg is also bolted on, and I have the front legs raked and splayed to give more width there for more stability. The jaws are held in place with a piece of wire, and this is just a clothes hanger that I've wrapped around to make it a little bit stiffer. And then the legs fit in the slot in the head here. And you'll see that I've got an angle cut on the legs here. These I made out of poplar to give me something a little bit more stout than pine wood, a little more flexibility to them. So they just slide back in. And you stick the wire in here. The wire is flexible, and it allows the jaws to move, and then they conform better to the workpiece that you have. Once the wire's in place, the jaws are set so that they are basically fixed, but there's enough flexibility in the wire that they will twist and move a little bit. One of the design features of the head on the horse is this wedge. You can see the head will move so that you can adjust the work distance. But once you find out where you want it, you can secure it with a wedge, tap it in place, then you have a nice solid work platform. Now the way the jaws work, you move your feet out and it'll clamp the spoon in place very tightly. So you have a very secure work piece and a very secure work platform. In designing this, I literally built up stacks of wood and sat on them and measured how high my knees were in order to make it comfortable for me to sit on the bench and not have to strain to hold this. So once I have my legs out, have some tension on these boards, my legs are relaxed now. There's no tension here. It's not going to wear you out trying to keep the spoon clamped in place. The other thing you have to consider if you're designing one of these is the height of the head itself. So this is a comfortable height for me to work. So if I'm working with a spokeshave, I'm not down here. I'm not reaching up high. That's going to put strain on my shoulders. It's at a very comfortable height for me. The spoon blanks I start out with, a long time ago made myself a cardboard cutout. This is roughed out with a bandsaw. In fact, I've cut it in that profile, and you can also see that it's cut in this profile. We'll show you that action on a bandsaw in a little bit. Some people don't have bandsaws, so there is a way to rough out spoons using an axe and a saw, and I'll demonstrate that here. This is actually just slab wood that came from an old cherry tree. I'm gonna look for the edges on it and find the thickest edge here, and that's gonna be the spoon part of the spoon. So trace my pattern. Now the grain on this wood is fairly straight, and there's a good chance that you would be able to split some of the big chunks of this off and not run into problems. However, there is a chance that you're going to split part of the spoon off. So the way to avoid that is to cross-cut the piece along the handle and then use your axe to split it off, and you can control where the wood is going to split. And now I'm right down at the base of the handle. I want to cut up here one more time just to make sure I don't split this off. And then the same thing on the other side. So obviously the closer you get to the correct dimension with your firewood or whatever you're starting with, the less sawing you're gonna have to do and the less work you'll have to do. This is the outline of the spoon, and you can see the saw cuts come right down to the line here. So now when I split this with an axe, you can see all the wood is gonna chip off at that point and not come into the handle or into the spoon part. So the wood is gonna split along the grain. I'm not gonna start right next to the handle here. I'm gonna start creeping up on it, just to make sure that the wood doesn't try to split into the handle that I want to keep. It looks like the wood's gonna cooperate with me. You see right down here where I cut, I did get a bit of a deviation there, so it's a good thing I started out farther. So I'm gonna have to be very careful in here and make sure that I don't split this out. Nope, it's not gonna work, so I'm gonna have to work that down from the other direction. And the same way here, this crack started going in. So now it's a matter of just working this down and get down to my saw cut lines. Another one of my hobbies is finding old tools and rehabilitating them. This axe I'm using is actually a hewing axe. You can see that it's the handle is bent on it, and it's only sharpened on one side for hewing logs or hewing timbers. So I'm gonna try to round off the spoon part. And I have to get down to this part where I was having the problem with it splitting in the wrong direction. So again, it's very very useful to find wood that has nice straight grain, much easier to work with. This is somewhat difficult getting this rounded part here. If you want to save yourself some axe work, you can make more saw cuts here to get that contour in there. And here's the area that I was having the problem with. That's pretty close. It looks rough, but the Spokeshave will take care of that. Now we go to the other side and see if we get lucky with it too. So this seems to be splitting off fairly well. See if I can split that off there. Yeah, that cooperated. Now just to round that off. My guess is if you had a smaller axe too, that you'd probably make this job a little bit easier once you get most of the wood split off. They do have axes that are specifically made even for carving. Now we've got a problem. So accidents do happen, and you see that there was a weakness in the wood as I was cutting. Anyway, I think you understand the process for using an axe to rough one of these out. And really this was very close to being able to use on the spoon mule. The only additional thing I would have done was trimmed off some of this backside to make the handle a little bit more slim. And get it more in this profile using the axe. So again, we want to start with this profile, and this is the blank that I cut out on the bandsaw. You can see the outside profile here is not quite symmetrical, and what I did on this one was touch it up on a disc sander so that I had a nice smooth curve and a nice round profile. So in order to make this one look like this, we're gonna have to run it through the bandsaw in this fashion. And one thing you have to be careful of is since the spoon is thicker than the handle down here, you need to make sure that you've got at least 2 points resting on the bandsaw at all times. Otherwise, if you're trying to hold this up and you get past this spoon part, the blade's gonna chatter and you have the risk of damaging your blade or breaking the blade on the bandsaw. The other thing I'll caution you is when you're starting this cut, you don't want to get too close to the top of this. You need to leave enough meat here so that the spoon can be hollowed out. If you cut this, you'll end up with a stubby front part of the spoon. So I'm gonna start out about here with the cut. The other thing I'll caution you is that you want the deepest part of the cut to be somewhere in the middle of the spoon, right about here. So we're gonna make this cut more or less like this. And again, this is just a guideline. I'm not gonna follow that exactly. But you can see that's more or less the profile of what I wanna cut. Now let's go to the bandsaw. So again, I'm gonna be very careful not to start too close to this edge. I'm gonna try to start close to where I have the pencil line there. And we're going to try to follow this contour along here. The other thing I want to make sure is that I've got the handle down on the bench when I start the cut and all the way through the cut so the blade doesn't chatter. We're just trying to rough this out right now so we don't have as much work to do with the spokeshave on the mule. One of the other design features about this that I didn't explain was this this gap in here. If you're carving a spoon that has a deep bowl part, the handle wouldn't sit down flat in here if this was up at the same height. You would have a gap in here, potentially break the handle of the spoon. So this allows the head to sit down in there tighter, but it allows for a different design of spoons. So my preferred tool for rounding off handles and for rounding off the bowl part of the spoon is a spokeshave. A lot of people use draw knives, some people use just regular carving knives, but to me a spokeshave is a much more efficient way of doing it. It's also much more controlled than trying to use a draw knife or a regular knife. Of all the people that I've given these spoons to, they've all complimented the thick handles. So this spoon is about 3/4 inch square back here. So really all I'm going to try to do is just knock the corners off. I don't like to see any flat parts on the spoon. So I try to round everything off up to the flat part. But one thing that'll give you a smoother cut is if you angle the spokeshave, it tends to slice more and give you a smoother cut. So after I've got those two corners rounded down, it's just a simple matter of flipping it over, and we'll start on the other side here. Sometimes you'll have grain that's working against you. The spokeshave works just as well going the other direction. So you can push or pull depending on what direction the grain's going. This spoon handle is nice and straight, so it really doesn't matter. When I made spoons on my using my bench vises, I never carved out the bowl part until I had the handle finished, because if you carve the bowl part out and put it in a vise, you'd crack it almost every time. So what I found with this spoon mule is I can turn this around and I can work on the bowl, I can work on the handle, and never have to worry about cracking the bowl part of the spoon. Now you remember I cut this down here as a slope. So if I'm gonna push this, I'm gonna start tearing grain here. So I'm probably gonna have to go back this direction to work this part of the spoon. Okay, so now I'm just gonna feel it a little bit, make sure I've got rid of the flat spots, make sure I've got it nice and round. I see right here I still have some more work to do to round this part of the handle off. When I cut it with the bandsaw, there's a little bulge right here. From an aesthetic standpoint only, it has nothing to do with the functionality of it, but there's a little bulge right here. So I'll look for those kind of things and kind of straighten those out if I can. Okay, I've got another tool here that I'm very fond of. It comes from Japanese Woodworker, and it's a little Japanese spokeshave. And the reason I like it is the sole right here is a lot more narrow than this. You can get into the corners. So here in the bowl part of the spoon where I have this cut out, this works a lot better for smoothing that out. And for me, again, personally, I like the taper of the handle coming down more narrow as it gets to the bowl, both in a side profile and looking at it head on. So I'm going to use this little Japanese spokeshave and work this this down here next to the bowl. You do have to be somewhat careful of the design. I've got friends down in Louisiana that when they fix gumbo, they fix great big pots of it. In fact, they asked me to make a spoon for them that's 18 inches long so they could stir in a spot. Well, it turns out that the stirring got so vigorous that they actually broke the spoon right in this area that I'm carving right now because I had it too thin. So I have to make sure when I make gumbo spoons that I leave enough meat there for them to do their stirring. Now you can see a lot more taper to the handle here. And to me, that just looks nicer instead of having it the same thickness all the way up to the bowl part of the spoon. And I tapered it this way too, and I like that that taper of the spoon. I'm ready to start working on the bowl part here now. And the first step of that is to give myself some guidelines So I'm just gonna freehand about an eighth of an inch or so away from the edge there, freehand the line to give myself a little guide for carving. And again, this doesn't have to be round. It doesn't have to follow this contour. It's you can design these and make any kind of shape there you want. Anything from perfectly round to an oval shape. If you wanted to be decorative about something, you can make this heart shaped even. So it's kind of up to you how you want to do that. So there's two ways you can mount this in the mule now. There's enough support right here on the edge of the mule that if I wanted to work on it like this, I could do that. I wouldn't have to worry about cracking it, which is something I have to be very careful of if I use my bench vise. The other option is to take advantage of this and put it here and clamp it. And if I did that, I would remove the head and turn it around backwards. So let's just do that. We'll take the head off and turn it around, and I'll work on the spoon in the other direction. I'm going to move the head up just a little bit closer to me also, so make it a little bit more comfortable. So we'll fasten our head down, make sure it's good and tight. So I've got my my pattern drawn here, and there are a lot of ways to hollow this out, and what I'm going to show you is my preferred way, obviously. But there are bent knives, spoon gouges, and regular gouges, a lot of different tools that have been made to hollow these out. And what I keep going back to is my 915 Swiss made gouge, because it's just very efficient at removing wood. And when I get down closer to the finished dimensions that I want, I'll use a spoon gouge, also Swiss made, that, that'll finish up and smooth out the job for me. You can start anywhere you want with this. You see I'm cutting across the grain, because if you cut with the grain, you get halfway through and you start going against it, and you don't want to do that. It just breaks it up. So to me, this is the most efficient way, just to hog out wood and remove the bulk of it. All these tools I showed you here today are available at Woodcraft. Another thing I'll recommend to you is if you're using these kind of gouges, go to Mary May Carving. She has a free video that shows you how to sharpen chisels. And that, to me, it's the most effective way that I've seen for sharpening these things. I think it would be in her free lessons category. She also has free lessons that teach you how to use a gouge properly. I like to try to get the whole bowl the same thickness, all from front to back and side to side. So that takes a little bit of practice, but it's not hard to do either. It's a combination of how you shape the back and how you dig out the front here. The one of the things I didn't say, I started out with this board that was about 7/8 of an inch thick. 3/4 inch dimension lumber works fine for spoons. A lot of people ask, what kind of wood do you use? I think most people would say that the preferred wood for spoons is some kind of fruit wood. Apple, Bradford pear is nice. This is cherry. You want a wood that doesn't have open pores. Like walnut is not a good wood because of the open pores in it. You get food in there and you got the potential for contamination. So I would not recommend oak, even though they do make very pretty spoons. If it was just a decorative thing, that'd be okay. Don't want to use resinous woods like pines. Some people say don't use walnut. My wife's got 3 or 4 walnut spoons that worked fine, and we haven't got any foul flavors from them. So I'm feeling the spoon, the thickness of the spoon here, and it feels about right in the middle and all the way up to here. It's a little bit thick in the back here yet, which is fairly typical actually, because that's where it joins the handle. So I'm not gonna try to go any deeper there. I'm just gonna clean things up and maybe take a little bit more off the sides here. Another thing I'll recommend to you is if you like spoons, if that's kind of your thing, go online and look up love spoons, carving love spoons. I get a big kick out of them, and if you want to give somebody a really nice gift, those kind of spoons are really nice. You can customize them to wedding anniversaries, births of kids, weddings in general, there's just a lot of things you can do with them. The variety, the design is infinite. Woodcraft has some nice books on love spoon carving, and as always, the internet's full of stuff like that. All right, that's kind of the shape I want. Now again, I said this is a number 9. This sweep that I have here is a number 8, so it's a little bit more shallow. It's not gonna tool lines aren't going to be as heavy, so I'm going to clean up some of this with this again. I'm cutting across the grain, but if you got nice sharp tools, you can do that fairly easily. If the wood starts tearing, you need to stop and sharpen your tools. So all I'm doing here is just cutting off the high points. I think I've got it pretty much the shape I want. See if I can smooth this up down here a little bit. If the wood starts tearing, chipping on you, it's probably because you're going into the grain. You just need to turn around and go the other direction and smooth it out. So that's that, as far as I'm concerned. I'm gonna go with that. The next step with this to smooth that out is to get a steel scraper and scrape that down and smooth it out real nice. But I'm gonna save that. I'm gonna start working on the back side of the bowl part now. And now I've pretty much determined the contour of the bowl part of the spoon. So the trick now is to make the outside match the inside. I've got a friend that watches me do this, and he looks at me and says, "I've got a side grinder that'll do that a lot faster for you." For this, but you don't get the same enjoyment out of it. There's something about working with your hands and feeling the wood and stuff that you don't get from machines. And I kind of enjoy the working with hand tools and doing things by hand. More than I do with machines. You see, again, I'm holding the spokeshave at an angle, so that I'm getting a slicing motion and not a straight cut like you might do with a draw knife. Remember, I said I don't like flat parts. So as I'm rounding this, I'm coming right up and meeting in the middle here, so there's nothing flat in the middle. You need to pick it up and look at it and make sure that you're getting a symmetrical curve to it. I got a little bit more to work on over here. That looks better. And then for this part here, to me it's easier just to push. And again, you have to push here because the grain is sticking this way. If you tried going this way, you'd be cutting into the grain. So I've got the spoon rounded off now from this edge to this edge and from the handle up here. So now I have to work on the front part of it. And a thing to be careful of is right at the very tip, the grain is sticking straight out at you. If you drag your spoke shave directly across it like that, you'll chip out the spoon. So it's very important that when you're working on this part, that you're slicing across the grain like this and not going straight down across it, or you'll tear the grain out. So now we're almost complete here. It's time to just kind of inspect, make sure the lines are the way you want them, make sure the handle's nice and round. I think this would look better if I narrowed that down a little bit more and got a little more flowing line right there. So when I get to this point, it's not so much brute force work anymore. It's just kind of I'll say finesse stuff. So I'm going to take this little Japanese spoke shave again, and just by hand, I'm going to start smoothing off spots and straightening up lines that I don't like. So this is a finished spoon, and the last thing I did with this is, instead of leaving this square end on it, I took the spoke shave and rounded off the end of it. That's personal preference thing. Some people like that square end. I tend to round off all the spoons that I make. So right now, you have a functional spoon. If I was going to give this as a gift to somebody, I would get out my 120 sandpaper and sand it all down. And one of the things I've come to realize is that sanding is also inspection. As you're sanding, you tend to see all the little defects and the other things that you need to clean up on there. So as you sand, clean things up, straighten out lines that you don't like, flat places that you don't like, go to 220 sandpaper and finish sanding it. And then for a finish, there are a lot of commercial products. Woodcraft sells a tried and true, which is a food safe, boiled linseed oil and beeswax, I believe is the combination there. There are recipes on the internet for making your own paste wax that you can put on here, which are, I think they're all basically beeswax based. The one I been using is mineral oil and beeswax. There's salad bowl oils that you can use. You can just get your vegetable oil out of the cabinet and rub a spoon down with that. Put a good coat on it, let it sit overnight, put another coat on it, rub it in. As you use it, they'll dry out. When it comes, you can lightly sand it again if you don't like the texture of it, and then just put some more vegetable oil on it, or beeswax and oil, whatever you prefer on it. But that's basically a utility kitchen spoon, simple spoon to make, and with a spoon mule.